So good evening, friends. Let me congratulate first all these three researchers, authors, who went around, led a team of people who surveyed quite a few stakeholders, and probably for the first time have a report of this kind. To understand what are the people involved in the water sector, as well as some consumers, you also did that, right? And the findings were just released. If you look at it, there are two parts of this. One is South Asia, and one is our own country, India. So looking at South Asia first of all, how do you call, what is South Asia? You can call South Asia in different ways. The South of Asia, or in context of, or we have SAARC, so we can say all those who are members of South Asian Association of Regional Cooperation are SAARC. But if you look at water, I would wonder how you will call South Asian water issues. Could we just confine it to those countries who you just mentioned? Or should you also include China into this? Bulk of the water, bulk of the rivers, you mentioned at least two of the three. Where do they originate? And normally, when we talk about water management, which is one of the areas which you thought there is only 18% respondents in India who felt water management is not important at all. If you look at water management, largely the wisdom demands that you should start from the source to the sea, because finally you start there and then water finally goes to the sea. Now I think South Asians are making sure that not much water goes to the sea anyway, because we are consuming it so much. But if you want to do it that way, which is the right way to manage water resources, then you must go to the source. And therefore, in the South Asian context, water management strategy must also include China. And obviously, China is very lucky. They are upper riparian, and therefore they would always sit pretty over this by saying, we have nothing to do with this. It's a South Asian problem, please deal with this. Chinese could tell the same thing to our good friends in Southeast Asia, but again the source is also partly also from there. Actually, at least more than 30% of the population of the world uses one source of water, that's the Himalayan rivers. And that's a very unique phenomena in the world, probably, that such a large number of people are dependent on one source of water. Therefore, to deal with this, and that's why my good friend Samir was probably mentioning, I realized it personally when I was dealing with one of the water issues while in the government of India. And therefore, I requested my friends in the Ministry of External Affairs that we should also engage with China on this. We should start talking to Chinese and work out a model, have a joint strategies to deal with water resource management of this particular part of the world. Fortunately, we started not through the government, completely out of it. We started dialogue with China, Pakistan, India, Nepal, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Afghanistan. And this is going on for the last 8-9 years. I'm in fact the founder of that. It's called Abu Dhabi Dialogue. Maybe camouflage, but it's Abu Dhabi Dialogue. It started in Abu Dhabi, so it continued. The idea was, how do you really create a water security for this largest chunk of people who are dependent on one source of that? And as we have gone through the IPCC report, maybe a little controversial in that aspect, only that aspect, is Himalayas are one of the most vulnerable ecosystem, and that of course I don't think it is debatable, but the glacier part was a little debatable. But Himalayas ecosystem needs to be maintained to maintain water security and livelihood security of this large number of people living in this part of the world. And therefore, if you come to sharing of water, it is always a contentious issue. In fact, I always believe that sharing of anything is contentious. If you want to share wealth, it is always contentious between state and the citizens also. And there's an eminent economist, he will tell you that when state wants to preempt the citizens' income by levying taxes, citizens don't want to part with taxes. That's also sharing of private income with the state and with the household. Want to share property between brothers, also it's not always happy. In fact, many of the crimes that are committed emanate from sharing of land also. So anything that you share, political power also, when you want to share, there is always a problem. So sharing causes a problem. So water sharing will definitely cause a problem. So sharing is a problem, but we thought, let us begin this process of a dialogue through one of the most challenging common denominator which faces everybody, and that's climate change. So why not enter this process of coming together by addressing one of the biggest issue facing all of us, but particularly the water sector, is climate change. And therefore, we actually are working on that. To find out how do we actually deal with water-related issues in the light of the climate change phenomena. And I think that's a very interesting issue. In fact, I don't know whether your attitude survey covered climate change part. So this is a very serious issue because climate change is undoubtedly going to affect water. And therefore, we started that. So this is a very interesting part. And in fact, South Asia, and again, I'm including in South Asian context water, at least three countries have got nuclear weapons. China, India, and Pakistan. So you just imagine that we are sharing common water resources. Water resources are always contentious, particularly the sharing part. And they are armed with one of the most weapons of mass destruction, which are never discovered somewhere else, but they are here. But India is never going to use it for anything. This is only a deterrent, but it is still there. And therefore, why not we try to resolve these issues in a very nice, proper manner, considering the geopolitics, considering the volatility, considering the importance of it, is a big issue. And therefore, I am very happy that you have done this attitude survey to find out what are the attitudes of people to deal with this issue. So many aspects of that, and one aspect is human development, economic development, particularly this South Asia, is largely dependent on water. Largely dependent on water. Agriculture consumes more than 80% of water in India and in most part of this region. China, of course, the percentage has gone down because of industrialization. But downstream, those countries that you have covered, water is the most important instrument of economic development, livelihood source, as well as because of water, the human development index is also very low in this region. If you look at infant mortality rate, if you look at health-related issues, most gender issues, many of them have implications arising out of water. And therefore, if you improve water-related issues, and I didn't realize Sanjay is here, I mean, Abu Dhabi dialogue are talking, he was looking after it. So, the point I'm saying is, the water is a source of even bringing in human development indices improvement, as well as the issues related to economic development. So it's a very important and vital issue. So we have to deal with that. Now, how do you deal with that? There are many ways of doing it. So, but first is understanding that without water resource development will not bring about economic development or human development indices to be improved. And therefore, this is a most important issue. There are many ways to look at it. And as I was saying, agriculture is one of the most important users of water. They consume it more. So we had made an effort, this is not again through Abu Dhabi dialogue, through other forums, that just look at it, Pakistan has to, India and Pakistan are the same province, which was when India Pakistan was created in 1947, Punjab was divided. Almost same agroclimatic condition, same almost cropping pattern, soil, you know, and largely irrigated area, one of the largest irrigated part of the world incidentally is there. So why not we look at like this to begin with? Pakistan farmers in Punjab, when they cultivate wheat or cotton, what is the efficiency level? How much water they consume in doing that? And why Indian farmers do that? Suppose even if we try to improve, where is better? If Pakistan is better, why not we improve the Indian standards of water efficiency to that level for those crops? In Bangladesh, same thing. Bangladesh was created by dividing the Bengal of that kind. So why not we use the cropping pattern as a starting point to understand the farmers? So when you do this attitude survey, if you look at farmers, attitude will be completely different than the attitudes of the others, because they realize the importance of water more than anybody else, because that's their livelihood. And therefore, could we start a process of doing like that and improve the issues? But this is the beginning. What should the objective? Could we think about, on a larger scale, a cropping pattern for the region? Could we think about the countries who are the most natural advantage of relative natural advantage, comparative natural advantage of growing a particular crop in a much better way? Should they not grow more, and then we can share it? So when we talk about benefit sharing, the benefit sharing will come in terms of where the water is finally used, and could the benefits of that could be shared? And therefore, could we think about cropping pattern as well? When we talk about agriculture as a means of doing that, could we think about that? Is something we really need to look at. But the benefit sharing is one of the very important areas. So climate change was the entry point, but over a period of time, we should think about benefit sharing. So how do you use water? We use water for irrigation, and that's where the cropping comes in. We use water for power generation. If it is hydro, it is a non-consumptive use of water. So we don't actually consume water like what when we use water for power generation for thermal project, where we need to use it for cooling purposes, so we actually use it. But here, we are using it on a non-consumptive basis. So could we not develop a joint hydro projects? One good example of this, though it's not a joint, but it's a joint in a way, Bhutan. We have developed joint projects with Bhutan. When I was a Minister of Power also, I had actually worked on that process. And now Bhutan has per capita income in South Asia, which is the highest, because we pay royalty to Bhutan. So has Bhutan lost out? Those water resources anyway wouldn't have been used by them, because Bhutan has a relatively very small demand for electricity. In any case, we can meet that demand by developing this. So first we meet Bhutanese demand, then we import that electricity into India. The entire evacuation network has been put by Indians. So therefore, this is a good opportunity, and such models can be developed. We can do the same thing with Nepal. We can actually develop some joint projects, which is benefit sharing project. But that's a very positive way to look at it. Could we also develop projects which are mitigating the hazards of this water project? What are the hazards? In next month, today we are having almost no monsoon in that part of the country, which grows a lot of agriculture. Unfortunately, it has been very deficient. But you'll see in August, Assam, Bihar will be flooded. So I used to always say jocularly that some of my media friends, that if they want to write a story on floods, they don't have to actually visit that part of the country where it is flooded. If they visited 3-4 years back, they can write the same story and it will not be inaccurate, because the same situation repeats itself every year after year. So flood causes such a damage to Bangladesh, causes damage to India. Could we not have a mitigation of this hazard strategy? So it's not joint only benefit sharing, it's also joint mitigation strategies to remove the hazards. And one of the great benefit sharing will be in the navigation sector. When actually Bangladesh was created, we lost Chittagong as a port. So the northeast of India, which is virtually landlocked, and therefore could we not therefore think about navigation as a means to at least to begin with move cargo, because probably movement of people will be a contentious issue anywhere. So rather than that, navigation can be used for movement of cargo. And anyway, the chicken neck through which we cannot move a lot of traffic from the northeast could benefit all the countries. And therefore, if SAARC is wanting to promote trade, But if you don't have the means of promoting trade, how will it happen? So navigation could be one of the another very interesting areas to work on. As I was saying, we need to find out a lot of issues where there will be commonality of interest. And the data is one of the most important issues. Data for early warning, data for sharing of information, and in fact the floods. We can actually, if we have a proper system in place, we can warn Bangladesh about floods quite a few days in advance. Because the water will anyway, when the river start in spate in this part of the country, there is a few more days before it starts getting into Bangladesh. So this is all possible to be done, and therefore could we actually build on that is an issue. And for that, we really need to create some instruments of cooperation. Where, how do you work? So joint river basin management on issue like that, we have been talked about. But we really need to do that, and therefore, if you start getting benefits, either way of tangible benefits which come in, or mitigation of those hazards which causes so much of damage. Incidentally, the flood causes more damage than droughts. Because when the floods come in, the entire infrastructure gets washed away. And therefore, this is already studied with many parts. So if the flood is the cause of the problem, how can we mitigate it? How can we do that? So these are the very many ways by which we can probably think about that. And to make that, I think the only beginning should be through dialogues, through benefit sharing. And over a period of time, we can have the confidence. And in fact, we can reduce the geopolitical tension as well if we develop this strategy as water. So water could be the means of promoting not only cooperation for economic development, not only cooperation for social development in terms of human development indices, but also could bring down the geopolitical tension that exists. And this could be a great spin-off benefit for this. And therefore, I think this South Asian water cooperation should be one of the very important issues that we need to deal with. One of the common problem, again, at least in India and Pakistan more, is a groundwater depletion. And therefore, it has both ways. So I think India and Pakistan may be in different countries, but they have the same attitudes. So we have depleted the water considerably. I think therefore, we really need to work on it in a proper way, and therefore we have no choice. Because when Pakistan was created in 1947, when Bangladesh was born in 1971, the rivers are not changed course, or rivers are not going to say that now I am going to produce more water because there are two more countries which have been created. So the same water, same number of people we need to share. So we need to find out, design our strategies to deal with the natural flow of water and to make that happen. So I think South Asian strategy could be one of the very important means of making so many benefits, and I'm happy that you have looked at it from a point of view of what attitudes people have. On India, I think we already know about Indian water strategy. One of the problems we are facing today, we really need to create, and we always talked about it. We are good in giving ideas and slogans. We have said we should have our Indian agriculture, which should be monsoon proof. So I think, but monsoon comes and goes, but that proofing has still not happened. So we need a proof that we have worked on the strategy, not monsoon proof, but a proof of strategy. So I think we really need to create a proper strategy in terms of how do you deal with the water issues, and that's one of the most significant challenges for India. Groundwater is going down. Surface water has always been a challenge. The quality of river water, and not just river water, but all our common water bodies, whether it's ponds, lakes, it is always a big problem. So I think one of the issues that we really need to deal with is how do you have an integrated water resource management strategy for Indian water resources. And we are only 4% of that. Groundwater is going down. Of course, the other day I was reading that we have discovered a new aquifer, which we always knew that it exists, in miles and miles below the surface. So I think now the human beings will go after that. So we have finished the first surface ground, now we'll go into that and finish that also. But before that, why not we manage the water resources? And this is one of the things that I was surprised when you say that only 18% people felt that water resource management is not a priority. Because probably they have not understood the question. Because there is no other way we can deal with water issues than by managing them. Because we cannot create water. We cannot manufacture water. The augmentation strategies for water are limited. So therefore the only water related strategies could be water resource management strategies. And therefore we really need to have an integrated water resource management strategies. We should include not just quantitative approach, but also qualitative in terms of improving the quality of water. And there will be a variety of issues. Some of them are common, like cropping pattern and others. But we will need to look at it and look at the storage issue in a little different way. Normally, it's always one of the most controversial issues in water resource management. There are people who are saying, why do you need storages? There's no need. So I think those who make such statement, and I respect them, welcome them, but they have an obligation to come out with an integrated strategy to prove that India's water storages today are enough and adequate. The nature has provided storages, and that's what I was saying, the flowing river, ponds, lakes, they're all also storages provided by nature. But unfortunately, they are just gone. Why they are gone? Maybe through our own indiscretion, but also because of fundamental reason, which is also common to more or less all South Asia, now China becoming an exception to that, is overpopulation. What is the population of India, undivided India, and what is the population of India today? What is the population 50 years ago? What is the population of today? So population has increased, which has also taken over some of the water bodies. And in fact, when we talk about strategies for water resource management, we should also understand its linkage with other sectors. Land and water, water and energy, water and food, many others. But point I'm saying is, we really need to have a strategy which must include storages. And therefore, I'm not even saying that storage means large dams or big dam. I'm not even saying a dam with dams. I'm not talking about that. But what I'm saying about is, how do you actually have a water security when we need the water, when we have got only 15 days of good rain during the best of times, of which the good quality rain is for few days. So when we have a fewer number of days where we get rain, and we need to use it for a much longer period, and our natural resources, our natural availability of storage is getting limited and limited, how do you create that? So first strategy would be to restore those natural resources. We must have a restoration of a big program we should have. And in fact, the National Rural Employment Guarantee Program should be directed toward that. In fact, when the parliament were debating this bill to make a law, in the parliament I even proposed an amendment that most of these funds should go into the villages for this cause, for water-related restoration projects. So by that, we create a storage anyway. We must do that. But after having doing that, looking at the long-term water security, we must also understand and what should be that optimum level that India must have. And this we should really think about. So that is one part of that. The other part is what you mentioned, and very interestingly, the religion part. I strongly feel that one of the most religious people, I mean, positive, negative, but people who believe in religion are in South Asia, most of them. They have this. So religion is a very important and strong instrument for influencing people's mind. Can we not use religion to tell people about water conservation? For telling people about how to have strategies wherein we do not waste water, use it, because that will have a strong influence on people's mind. As an environment minister, I had called all the religious leaders of all religions and told them that why don't you try to protect biodiversity, because you believe in creator, the creation is biodiversity. And if you protect creation, the creator will be very happy. So why not we actually try to promote the conservation effort. So I think this is a very interesting point that you made, and we should try to use as many influences as possible on the human mind to bring about a strategy wherein water-related issues will get properly addressed. There are many interesting points, and there are so many interesting issues, but one point I will touch and I'll stop is the governance issue. I think whatever we may have strategies can be many. But to put strategies in place and to get the desired outcome of those strategies, we need to have a governance in place. And that governance must be local, even at the smallest possible unit like village. It must be district, it must be state, and it must be also at the center level. And particularly when we're talking about this ambitious project of South Asian cooperation, we could think about that even at between the countries, a little later, but we really need to put this in place, at least in each of these countries. If you have that in place, it will get probably the desired result. So governance is one of the most important aspects of that, and I'm happy that this also was one of the part of his study. So I'm very happy that there are many players. I know there are quite a few persons in this region who are working on all these issues, but this is type of a survey will be very helpful. I remember we had done a survey some time ago on power, and people were saying that everybody wants free power. So I'd asked a lot of farmers' organization, do you really want free power? They said, no, you are wrongly asking me a question. We never ask for free power, we are asking for power. And the implication is that when you give promise us free power, we don't get power. So please give us power, don't give us free power. So people, actually speaking, want something which we don't understand and we try to give them that they don't want. What people want is a good quality water. What people want is a reasonable, good supply of water. And therefore, we'll need to do that. Of course, one question, and which, because Mr. Price is here, the pricing issue has already been coming. So I don't want to discuss that issue because that is another issue which will go on for a very long time. But there are issues which relate to demand side management, which can also be addressed through some of these instruments. The demand side management can never happen if there is everything which is not really, the value of that is not properly realized. And therefore, we really need to work on quite a few issues. I'm sure, and I was very happy to see so many of you coming here for this evening function, showing your interest in water. But I think you also said that after this, there is going to be cocktails, so we add water into something. So I think that's something also probably will be exciting for at least few of you, if not all of you. So I don't want to wait any longer between you and that. So I would like to thank my friends, my good friend Samir, Sarah, and also Mr. Price for bringing in this interesting issue. Thank you all for being here. I only hope that this again becomes one more contribution to development of our common water development strategies for India and for South Asian region. Thank you very much.